My name is Steve Hunter, and you're watching Down the Highway.
On this episode of Down the Highway, Ian makes his way across the desert to Arizona to talk with the deacon himself, Steve Hunter. Steve has played with the likes of Peter Gabriel, Lou Reed, Alice Cooper, Tracy Chapman, and Dr. John, just to name a few. Ian sat down with Steve to talk to him about his amazing and prolific life in music.
Arizona with Steve Hunter. Steve, I have to use my cheat sheet here right away because your track record is pretty impressive. Not only do you have solo records, and you know, you've played with Alice Cooper, Lou Reed, you've recorded with Aerosmith, I believe, as well. Peter Gabriel, David Lee Roth, Julian Lennon, I think, right? Dr. John, Tracy Chapman, Glenn Campbell, the list goes on. How long have you been doing this professionally?
It sounds like I can't keep a job, though, doesn't it?
No, well, this is impressive. In rock and roll, that's good, the more jobs you have.
That's right, yeah. No, I started what I would call professionally, really, in about 1971. I went up to Detroit, Michigan, and auditioned for the Mitch Ryder Band. There was a Mitch Ryder Band at the time called Detroit, after the Detroit Wheels had broken up. The Detroit Wheels were sort of a soul R&B band with little rock undertones.
Okay.
And then the band broke up, and Mitch Ryder sort of reformed the band with the drummer Johnny Badanjic, who was the original drummer of the Detroit Wheels. They put together a rock band, just a straight-out hard rock band, and they called it Detroit. And at the time around 71, they were looking for a guitar player. And a friend of mine from Decatur played bass. With them. His name is John Sauter, superb bass player. He called me up and he said, listen, you got to come up to Detroit. They are auditioning guitar players for this band called Detroit with Mitch Ryder. And I said, okay. So I literally threw my guitar in the back of my car and drove it close to 8 hours up to Detroit and auditioned.
Wow.
And the wonderful thing about that story is that it was the first time I ever actually saw in the flesh a Marshall half stack.
Really?
And I got to plug in and turn it up. And the sound that came out was so heavenly, I really didn't care whether I got the gig or not. I just got to play through a Marshall. And I got to hear how really good it sounded.
So the 16-hour round-trip drive would have been worth it just for that.
It was worth it for that. And it turns out I did get the gig, but I didn't know any of their songs. They didn't send me songs to learn. They just said, come up and we'll jam and see what happens.
Right.
And we jammed on Cream tunes and Hendrix tunes. And it just was the most wonderful sound. Johnny B. Badanjic is one of the best rock drummers, blues drummers ever. I mean, when here I am working with these guys, and I was blown away. So I ended up getting the gig. And through that gig, they had a record deal, and it turns out the producer was a guy named Bob Ezrin. And that was the first time I met Bob. And he and I just sort of hit it off right from the get-go. He was there when I auditioned. I didn't know who he was. He was just kind of standing off in the corner.
Okay.
I found out who he was. I didn't know what a producer was, any of that stuff.
Right.
He was really cool. And when we got into the studio, I really loved the way he worked and the sounds he got and the arrangement ideas and all that stuff. And it began a really long relationship with Bob. We've done a lot of stuff together.
Well, some of this, half the list I rattled off, I think he was a part, right? So actually what I want to do is back up then, because that's when basically your professional career started.
Yes.
Because you and him probably locked in, and that's it.
That's until
now.
Yep.
So when did you start playing music?
I started when I was 8.
Nice.
When I was 8 years old. In fact, that little amp back there, my dad bought for me when I was, but I started on lap steel. Because my dad was really kind of cool. It's an interesting story to me. I don't know about anybody else, but I was in grade school and these suit people, we called them, came by. They looked weird. You know, they were all black suits. It's almost like Matrix or something.
Okay.
They come by and they have briefcases and they have all these things. And they said, we're going to give you guys a bunch of tests. Don't worry, you can't flunk them. You know, they're not that kind of test. We just want to... It's a little game we're going to play to find out what you know, what you're good at. So for a week, we went through all this barrage of, it was really kind of cool. It was a game of math and science and English and music.
Okay.
And apparently, I scored really high in music. So they called my dad, my mom and dad, and they said, you know, your son scored really high in math and science, but really high in music. So you should ask him if he'd like to play an instrument. So my dad takes me aside and he said, do you want to play an instrument? And I said, yeah, I'd love to play an instrument. He said, well, what do you want to play? And I said, drums.
Good and choice.
Dad said, no, it's got to be music. So when I tell that story to the drummer, they love it.
Yeah.
But he meant notes. You know, I know what he meant. But I said, okay, guitar. It was my second choice. And I didn't know there was a difference between lap steel and regular guitar. I was 8.
Yeah, it just had strings.
Yeah, had strings on it. My dad used to noodle around on a guitar, and I was completely enamored by the sound of it. Even when I was 3-4 years old, it was the most amazing sound to me. So he said, well, how about lap steel? So I didn't know what that was. I said, sure. So I started taking lessons on lap steel, and I really loved it.
And, that's a great instrument.
For about 4 or 5 years, I played lap steel. And then I heard a guy named Chet Atkins.
Yeah.
And that kind of, oh, now wait a minute now. Something's going on here. How's he doing that?
How's he making that come out of this? I can't make it happen.
All this stuff is coming out. How's he doing that? So my dad got a little frustrated at me because he had sunk a lot of money and time into the lap steel. We weren't very rich, so he had to work an extra job to my lessons and stuff. So I kind of felt bad, but I said, Dad, I gotta play this regular guitar now. You know, it's time to move on to that because I heard Chet Atkins.
Yeah, right.
And so he was cool with it after a while, and I started really trying to get into playing how Chet played. And I wasn't really good at it, but it was ironic because some of the right-hand technique I learned on lap steel just adapted itself to regular guitar.
That makes sense.
Wonderful. So I didn't have to really learn anything on my right hand. I just had to learn a lot of left hand.
That's what I was going to ask. Now, yeah. Instead of holding a bar, you have to now hold positions. Yeah, exactly.
You know, on the old torturous F bar chord, you know,
it took
me forever to get that.
Banjo thing. Probably would have been easier for you to learn.
Oh, much easier.
Because, you know what I mean? Just hold the position.
Exactly. But no, I really enjoy it. And then, of course, as things progress through history, suddenly there's these guys named Jimi Hendrix and Eric Clapton and Jimmy Page and Michael Bloomfield and all these guys. I was, whoa, these guys are doing some stuff with guitar that's really amazing. How are they doing that? Now I'm sucked right into it now.
Yeah, yeah.
And I start hearing, and their interviews, they started mentioning people like B.B. King and Albert King, and I didn't know who those people were. And I really got a bit angry because I found out that they were American black musicians that I'd never heard of. And that really hurt me a little because here I'm finding out from English guys about these black guys who are literally in my backyard.
Yeah.
And I don't know anything about them. So I was really pissed at myself about that. So in my small town of Decatur, Illinois, I couldn't find blues albums anywhere. So I had to go to Champaign, which is the University of Illinois there. So it's a more college town, it's more open. And I bought as many as I could get my hands on, as much money as I had. I think I bought about 5 B.B. King albums.
Nice.
And then I just dove headlong into blues because I just absolutely loved blues. One of the reasons I thought was because I thought, oh, this is simple. You know, it's 3 chords, and B.B. King only plays like 4 or 5 notes. This is easy.
Right.
And the more I dove into it, the more I realized, oh, this isn't easy at all. This is really difficult.
that era with those players, yeah, you're right. When you initially hear it, you're like, well, this is simple enough, but there's so much personality coming out of those guys.
Well, there was a lot of stuff. Yeah,
there was their guitar was inherently their guitar. Yeah. Their guitar sound was inherently their guitar sound.
Well, you learned that there was a lot of noise comes out of their fingers. I didn't know any of that stuff. And Clapton and Page and all those guys really just played blues, only played it louder.
Yeah, they mimicked well the basic things, and they do it really well.
Yeah.
But there was that's what I'm saying. One of my favorites is Howlin' Wolf, and he doesn't pick up a guitar very often or a harmonica very often. Yeah. But when he does, I know it's him.
Yeah,
you know it's his voice, but you also know when he's kind of strumming a guitar.
Yeah, it's like Jimmy Reed, too.
Exactly.
They all have their thing.
You know? You're like, okay, this could be any guy, but I know for sure. Yeah, that's Howlin' Wolf.
Well,
Jimmy Reed.
That just blew me away. Now I actually went to see B.B. King at a place called Mr. Kelly's in Chicago, and that was another long drive. It was about 5 hours. I was in a band, a local band called the Light Brigade in Decatur, and we were B.B. King freaks. We did a whole set. You know, in those days, you did six sets, in a bar and stuff.
Yeah, right.
So one of our sets was all B.B. King, and our singer said, hey, B.B.'s playing at Mr. Kelly's, we gotta go see him. So we drove all the way up to Chicago and bought a couple of really expensive Cokes so we could see him. And oh my God, he was flawless. He just blew me away. And after the show, he was kind of hanging out in front of the stage, and I thought, wow, I'm going to go up and talk to him.
Mm-hmm.
So I ran up, like, here I am, I look like a hippie farmer kid, So I run up to him and I said, BB, oh man, it was an amazing show. And he was such a gentleman and very kind. And I started blurting out things like, I've been trying to play. I've been listening to your records. I've been trying to play like you, and I don't know what I'm doing wrong. I can't get it to work, and it doesn't sound like blues. Is it because I'm white? And he laughed at me. He said, "Well, no, of course it's not." I said, "Well, I don't have soul? Maybe." He said, "No." He said, "Look." He said, "Look. Have you ever been hurt by a girl? Treated bad by a girl?" I said, "Well, yeah." He said, "You remember what that feels like?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Well, you put that in your fingers. That's the blues." And my heart stopped. That was like the most profound thing anybody had ever said to me about music.
Yeah, that's a turning point right there.
Right there.
You probably went, "Oh, I get
this."
Two
with him, because the second one, he said, "Look, man, don't try to copy me. Learn from the records, but you got to make it your own. That's what keeps it alive." Now, that's two things that altered my entire outlook on music and affected my entire career from that moment on.
That's amazing.
Everything I did from that moment on was based on what he said to me that night. It was the most extraordinary thing. I went home. I drove all the way home with my bandmates. I got home about 4 a.m. I couldn't sleep. I was so blown away by this is the king of blues. Just told me this. You make it your own.
Mm-hmm.
But B.B. King said I'm supposed to do that.
Yeah.
So I'm going to do that.
Now you got to be careful how you present that to your bandmates.
Oh my God!
They're like, "Hey, what are you doing?" Hey, B.B. King said
they were pretty thrilled actually because it changed my approach to playing and wow, what are you doing? And I would learn a little riff off the album. I had 5 B.B. King albums that I put on a turntable that had a changer, the automatic thing, and I would play along with all 5 records, and then turn it over and play the other side. On all 5 records.
Straight through.
And I every time I'd pick something up from BB, I would wait till the end of the record and I'd fool around with it and try, well, how would I play that? I'm going to try it like this, And suddenly this whole world opened up to me. It's like, wow, I can play blues like me.
That's amazing.
Oh, it was.
That's amazing. And from not just discovering that on your own or having a music teacher or a local legend.
Yeah.
You walk up to BB King. Who isn't really surrounded by anybody.
No.
Really, he's just kind of there.
Kind of hanging.
Hey, kid, this is what you got to do. You're all right. Yes, sir.
Oh, it was hilarious. I got his autograph,
That's
amazing. I got a pick, which I lost, of course. But it was he was such a gentleman and so kind to take me and say, "Nah, man, you're not doing anything wrong. Your attitude's a little wrong. You got to adjust that and you'll be fine."
Well, you were ready to receive that information from him, too. I was going to say, just because you lost the pick, it doesn't matter because you know what? He gave you your career.
Yeah, he did.
Is what it sounds like to me. I mean, yes, you were playing with your buddies and you were in bands and you had been playing since you were 8 years old.
Yeah.
And your father helped you with all that's all great.
Yeah.
But I feel like at that point,
yeah,
He started your career.
He started.
Because your brain just switched, you know.
From that moment on, I was concerned about how I'm going to play stuff.
Yeah.
And that was extraordinary.
Yes,
because all the way up until then, I've been trying to play like Chet Atkins. And then I would listen to Michael Bloomfield and try to play like Michael Bloomfield.
Right.
And he said to me, no, that's not the way you do it. You learn from him, but then you make it your own. You adopt it all and adapt it and make it your own. That's what keeps it alive. And he was so right about that. It just changed my whole life.
So my next question, which you kind of answered a little bit, is, you know, you learned, then you picked up the guitar and you did that, and you had this band that when the BB King thing happened.
Right.
Were there other bands like garage? Well, this wasn't even a garage band. You were playing out with these guys.
Yeah, we were playing clubs.
So was there some garage stuff leading up to that, or this was kind of the first band? And
well,
you guys...
it was really the first band that really went out and made some money.
I mean,
we were making a little bit of money, not much, but we were making a little bit of money, and we were having a good time. We were pretty much playing it was a cover band, but we sort of played stuff our way. You know, the keyboard player, Ron Stockert, played B3, and he had this wonderful knack of doing, we played some Chicago songs where he would get this sound on a B3 that you'd swear it was horns. I don't know how he did it.
But interesting.
He'd play the horn parts, and it sounded like horns.
Yeah, because Hammond B3s are Hammond B3s.
Yeah.
They just have that sound, but it's interesting how that...
I don't know how he did it, but he did. And
so you guys are magical.
Yeah, and we ended up doing a lot of, we had a lot of fun with that band, and we were playing around gigs with like REO Speedwagon was still kind of trying to get a deal, and we were kind of playing a lot of gigs around with those guys.
Okay, so
and,
you were kind of in that same
school. Yeah, little circuit that we did.
Got it.
Yeah.
And then so when you went up and got the gig we were talking about earlier when you met Ezrin and whatnot,
right.
Was that out of that band? Is that when you got the phone call?
Yeah.
Okay, so that was kind of the last...
That was the last local band I was in.
Right.
White Brigade.
And then, okay, so then that's why I wanted to jump back to where we kind of... Because we kind of were jumping around like a Tarantino film kind of.
Yeah.
My fault, I'm jumping us around because there's so much stuff going through my head.
Right.
So yeah, let's go back to I guess, the professional career starting. So what we were talking about before, Detroit.
Yeah.
Now, how far did you go with those guys before you went on to the next thing?
Well, we did an album. We did the album, and there were some personnel changes. A couple of the guys, John Sauter, my friend, and this keyboard player named Boot Hill, they left the band, and we got two more people in. They did half the album, and then these two other guys came in, and then the guitar player left, and we got him. There was a lot of switching around of members during the album, but I stayed in there with the B and Mitch Ryder, and I had signed the deal with him, the record deal with him. And we did the record. We did some really hardcore touring. I mean, you know, driving 48 hours to get to Wyoming.
It's
horrible driving and stuff, and all across Canada. And we really tried hard to break that album. We thought there were some good songs. What we felt like we wanted to be was sort of like the American Rolling Stones, or Zeppelin maybe, but Rolling Stones in the fact that we were rootsy,
right?
But powerful,
right?
And that's what we were trying to. The band really rocked. I mean, it was a hard rocking band, really tight, and I loved playing with them. So, but it just, we weren't getting a lot of help from the label at all to help support the record, and there were some things that we had put out rock and roll. We did a version of Lou Reed's Rock and Roll. Now, I have to talk about this because that's kind of how I met Lou. I had come up with an arrangement for a Lou Reed song called Rock and Roll. And Mitch wanted to do it. Mitch Ryder wanted to do it, and we hadn't come up with an arrangement. I went out and saw Leslie West with Mountain a couple nights before, and it was one of my favorite bands. And I came back from this show, and in my head, I was working on this arrangement, and I thought, well, how would Leslie play this song? How would he do it? How would Mountain do this song? And this arrangement came out.
Wow.
It just sort of flooded out. So I showed it to the band next day, and they loved it. Bob loved it. So it got on the record. And then Lou heard it in New York on Long Island. There was a racetrack out there that was playing it as background music. And he recognized it. Hey, wait a minute, that's my song.
So this is a complete, this wasn't even, you know, the producer introducing it to him,
no.
Right? But this is a totally
as a
chance
matter of fact, he,
fluke.
Lou tried to track down Bob and me.
Wow.
So it was like totally backwards.
Yeah, you had no idea until there was a phone call. Hey, Lou wants to talk to you. What?
I get Bob Ezrin calls me, and he said, this is after I left the band, after I left Detroit and left Michigan. Bob calls me. I'm back home in Decatur. And Bob calls me and he says, hey, you know, Lou wants to do an album with us. And I said, oh, wow, really? And he says, yeah, it's this album. It's going to be called Berlin. And he sort of told me about the album. I said, oh, that sounds wonderful. We're going to do it in London. I'd never been to London. So I was really excited. So that's how that happened, was because Lou heard my version.
That's amazing.
Rock and roll, yeah.
See, again, that's like one of those complete chance,
yes,
things.
It's a serendipity thing, or
yeah,
there's all these connections, you know. I mean, if I look back on my career, it's funny how everything sort of just connected with everything else.
I think that's just kind of how life works in general, but I think there's times where you know, the mark is missed.
Yeah,
you're like, oh, if I didn't leave 10 minutes, yeah. You know, there's like I think a famous story with the Rolling Stones. I think when they were going to replace oh, shoot, who was the one that took over after...
Oh, Ron Wood, you mean?
Ron Wood in. Mick Taylor.
Yeah.
I think Mick Taylor was leaving, and I think the Stones were hanging out somewhere in, you know, a bar or something, and Ronnie Wood walked in, and they were talking, who are we going to get to replace Mick Taylor? And then Ronnie Wood walks in, and I think he says, hey, guys, how's it going? And I think Keith was like, hey, do you want to be in the Stones? Yeah. I mean, it was like something ridiculous like that. If Ronnie Wood didn't walk in the door while they were sitting there talking...
I wanted to be in that band so bad, yeah, I can just tell you. I was trying to find out how I could get over to... When are they? Are they going to audition anybody?
Yeah.
And then I found out they wanted to keep it an English band, so it's all good.
Yeah, you're like, fair enough. It's no fault of mine that I was born in the States, right?
I didn't care whether I got the gig. I just wanted to jam Stones tunes with the Stones.
I know.
I thought, just to play with Keith, I'll be happy. That's it. You know, I know. And if I don't get the gig, that's all right. You
know? Yeah, I know. It's pretty. Yeah, that band. I would want to. I still want to do the same thing.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
Still, if I could, you know.
Yeah.
I'm not going to get the phone call, though, I'm sure.
No, I'm not either.
the Lou Reed thing. So moving on to Do Berlin, was that the second thing? Was that basically the second?
That's the second album I did, yeah.
Okay, so right out of the gates, it was just like, okay, Lou Reed called after the Detroit thing. So, all right, let's go this way and see what happens.
And the bass player that I play with in England is Jack Bruce, one of my heroes.
Yeah.
From Cream. Cream was my band. That was my band. I played their stuff. I learned so many things from Clapton.
Mm-hmm.
Little techniques, bending techniques, and it was my band. I still have all their albums, you know.
Good, yeah.
excuse me. Here I am. I'm actually going to play with Jack Bruce, and Ainsley Dunbar was the drummer, one of the best drummers ever, and later on B.J. Wilson, and Steve Winwood. I thought I'd died and gone to heaven. It's the second album, and here I am playing with these guys.
I was going to say, you were still fairly green.
I was totally green.
I mean, you know, on that level, you know, you'd done a bunch of other stuff. But, yeah, that's kind of, like, what do you do? Walking into a room with those guys.
Well, I knew there was going to be one of two things happen. Either I was going to completely fall on my face, or it was going to kick me in the butt and help me play better probably than I've ever played.
Right.
So... thank God. It turned out to be I didn't fall on my face.
It's good.
I just joined in and just rode this wonderful horse, you know, with Jack over here playing bass and Ainsley over here playing drums, and I was just riding along. It was wonderful.
That's amazing.
It's just like riding a Harley down the road, even though I've never actually driven one. I've ridden on one, but I've never driven one. And it was just like that. Just grab a hold and enjoy the ride. That's what it was like.
That's amazing.
I loved it.
Which I'm sure snowballed all that stuff. That ride took you through that list I rattled off. I'm sure that's how it just, on to the next one, you know. And, you know, I'm a Lou Reed fan and a Velvet Underground fan, and a lot of people out there are. How long were you with him? Because I know you did Berlin, but I think you're on a couple live records as well.
Yeah, Rock and Roll Animal and Lou Reed Live.
Okay, and so obviously you did all numerous tours.
Yeah, well, not numerous, really. Be honest with you, in 73, we did Europe.
Okay.
And then we came over and did a small little tour in America where the Rock and Roll Animal album was recorded in New York City at a place called the Academy of Music. It's changed names now, but it was the Academy of Music. And we recorded that and Lou Reed Live. We did two shows in one night. Then he sort of changed his direction. I think he... he did the rock thing, and he kind of wanted to go into this sort of R&B-ish kind of funk thing for a little while with Sally Can't Dance and that. But years later, I was very sad when Berlin was sort of panned and nobody liked it. It hurt me as much as it hurt Lou. That album had become a personal thing to me.
Of course.
When I listened to it, I got to sit and listen with Bob Ezrin to the whole album. He had sequenced it on quarter-inch tape, and I listened to the whole album, and I was completely stunned at how good it was. I mean, I hadn't heard it in sequence. That we'd recorded it out of sequence, and there were some I didn't play on, so I didn't hear all the album. And Bob played it for me, and I was stunned. I thought, my God, I just played with a genius. And Bob, I found out that night what a genius he was, because he didn't have much to go with on when he did that the production. He had Lou's singing with an acoustic guitar and a vocal in a little Radio Shack cassette player, and he built that whole album out of that. I mean, it was extraordinary.
So he actually did a lot of, as far as the production side, he did a lot of the arrangements.
Well, it was
all
stuff that Lou and he worked out. They worked out together, obviously.
Sure.
But Lou said, yeah, let's just go with it. And it was, God, it was magnificent. And yes, it was a tragedy. And yes, it's very sad. And it's dark. And it's in the 70s. I don't think anybody wanted to hear any bad stuff about drugs. But it was not, there was some ugly stuff happened.
Yeah.
But I loved it because wow, this is magnificent.
Yeah.
You know? And it really hurt me when it got panned. It really, really hurt me. And I thought, oh my God, am I that far off on what I think is good? You know, I mean, I think that's brilliant. And look at everybody panned, Rolling Stone panned, everybody.
Yeah.
So I got really hurt. And Bob and I and Lou had always talked about, wouldn't it be cool if we could do this entire album live from start to finish, just like the record. Maybe embellish it a little, but just like a choir, everything. So I thought, well, it's probably not going to happen now. Well, Bob calls me like 40 years later, and he said, hey, guess what? We're going to do the Berlin album live, start to finish. You're kidding me. Really? How'd that work? So something happened with St. Anne's Warehouse in New York. It's an arty place.
Right.
They get grants and stuff to do various kinds of art things. And the people there really were dying to do Berlin. So they put together this package, and I flew out to New York. It's one of my favorite places anyway.
Sure.
And we started rehearsing. I couldn't believe I was sitting on stage getting ready to rehearse the Berlin album, which we wanted to do 40 years earlier.
Wow.
And now we're getting to do it. And there behind me was a children's choir, and over to the left of me was four horns and four strings. And when those kids started singing Sad Song, it almost brought tears to my eyes. I had to fight it back. And I looked over, and Bob was crying.
Wow.
There were tears. It was like the culmination of 40 years of waiting.
Yeah.
To do that.
That's amazing.
It was awesome. It was one of the most magnificent things that's happened in my career.
What year was that?
Karen, do you remember what year that was? About 2005, wasn't it? Something like that.
Yeah. I was gonna say, I couldn't remember if it was like late 90s or early 2000s.
No, it was mid 2000s.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's right. God, isn't that amazing? It's amazing how stuff can come back full.
That just killed me.
Circle. Yeah.
That was released in 73, so it was 42 years later.
Yeah.
You know, it's pretty amazing.
That's incredible.
And it was so well received. That was another thing. So okay, Lou, you just wrote we did an album 40 years too early.
Well, and sometimes that's how that works. I mean, you know, we can talk about a lot of artists like that, from Delta Blues to punk rock to whatever.
Yeah.
And it's unfortunate sometimes, but also I think it's kind of, like you said, the way you felt being on stage doing that.
Yeah.
And when you actually had all the pieces of the puzzle, which you weren't there for in the studio, you do your parts and you leave, but you're on stage with, like you say, with the horns, the strings, the children's choir.
It's wonderful.
And when it starts hitting you, you're like, wow, you know, it's too bad it took 40 years, but I'm so glad I'm here.
I enjoyed that every single night. Every single night we did that. Every time I heard those kids sing, and we had a few different choirs because of something about the child labor law.
Yeah, right,
you can't have, you know. So there were different choirs coming in and out all the time, and from different schools in Europe. It just was the most beautiful sound. to stand there. The song I'm talking to is Sad Song, which is the last song on the album. Mm-hmm. It has horns and strings, and it's a big, huge, huge epic song. We just didn't want it to stop. It's like, let's just play the ending forever. Let's just not stop. Let's tomorrow morning sometime.
Yeah, yeah, you know, yeah. Once we'll the last person walks out, yeah, we'll do it another hour.
If they're all asleep, then we'll stop.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was just magnificent. Definitely one of the high points of my career, that.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah, gosh. I mean, already we only talked about like two of these people, and the two of the stories are great. I don't even know where to go from here. Well, okay, so, well, actually, you ended up spending, it seems like, a really decent amount of your time with Alice Cooper.
Yeah.
Right? Like a handful of years.
Yeah, quite a few, yeah.
So we talk about that. If you know that, so you did some studio records,
yep,
some live records,
yep,
and of course a lot of touring.
A lot of touring, yeah.
And was there writing involved on your behalf? Okay.
And that's a drag. I wish I could have written a few things, but yeah. I don't think my writing was really up to snuff yet. You know, I'm still learning how to write. So, and Dick Wagner, the other partner guy, he and I did a lot of stuff together. Dick's a great songwriter. So he worked really well with Alice and Bob. The three of them wrote most of the stuff. The Welcome to My Nightmare, Alice Goes to Hell, Lace and Whiskey, a lot of that stuff. Dick was a great songwriter. So you put him together in a room with Alice and great songs came out.
Yeah.
So I didn't have a hand in it, though, unfortunately.
But you got to be there and perform. And
I got to play.
Yeah. I'm sure it was a great group of guys.
Great group of guys. That was another, we had a lot of fun.
The funniest thing that I remember seeing about Alice Cooper, and they actually kind of touched on it in the Wayne's World movie. Remember where they wanted to go rock with him? He started telling them like facts about, you know, Milwaukee or whatever. He really was a pretty calm, straight-laced kind of just like, hey, this is my job.
Yeah.
Like, you know.
Alice Cooper is a character.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah, he's very theatrical, yeah, you know, which I always thought was really cool because I don't know why. I just thought it was really cool. He just seemed completely different than his character.
He is. Yeah,
he completely is, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
But in a good way, you know.
In
I don't know him. I've never met him, but.
No, I've known him for a long, long time now. Met him in 71, so I've known him for a really long time. And I did some recording on the Billion Dollar Babies album before the band broke up. And then when Alice went solo, I did the Welcome to a Nightmare and Alice Goes to Hell, Lace and Whiskey, and then we did a live album called The Alice Cooper Show.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was touring all through there. I toured from about 75 until I think around 79. And then he was about due for a change too, in a shift in his,
mm-hmm,
I mean, that's a natural evolution.
Well, just how artistry works. That's how business works.
Yeah,
I mean, and of course, and the music business, you know, better than I do along the way evolves.
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes, you know, you just have to evolve with it.
But then it's kind of funny because about 2010, I get back in the studio with Alice. It's like, for a while there, I was thinking my resume was starting all over again.
Yeah.
You know, because I ended up touring with Mitch Ryder, too, in 2000, mid-2000s.
All right.
I toured with him in Germany. And then Lou Reed.
Reed.
And then Alice Cooper again. It's like, well, I'm waiting on Peter Gabriel to call.
Yeah, right. There you go.
Just go right down the line and start all over again.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, I mean, again, and that's, you know, with art, with fashion even, and with whatever, things loop back around.
Yeah,
you
it's
know?
Pretty cool. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, you know? People go, the new generation.
Yeah.
Says, hey, that Berlin record was fantastic. We have to do this, you know, or whatever, however it happens.
Yeah.
So that's been, well, let me also briefly, I wanted to ask, so just what we've talked about so far, you know, kind of blues into rock and roll, kind of whatever, into Alice Cooper, which was rock and roll, but it was, you know, metal-ish. It wasn't heavy metal, but, you know, so how did, I mean, and I know there's not a big difference between all of those types of music, but did you have to adapt in any way? Did you like or dislike some of the stuff you did along the way? Like, I don't really want to play this heavy stuff, or I don't want to play this lighter stuff.
I looked at the Alice Cooper stuff as just kind of hard rock and roll. And
okay.
A good way to describe what happened to, when I was doing Billion Dollar Babies, I of course had seen Alice live, and once 18 broke, they just were huge all of a sudden, and it really literally was overnight. They were enormous. So I'd seen them live, and I knew them all. They were all good friends of mine. So when I walked in the studio, the first song, I go in the studio, and Bob Ezrin says, okay, listen to the song, and I'll show you where I want you to play. He wanted me to do a little soloing. So he plays this song called Sick Things. And it's this really hard, deep, you know, it's like really, it's like Frankenstein.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like a horror movie. And I'm thinking, oh my God, what's he want me to do on this? You know, and I was like panicking because I don't know, what the hell am I going to play on this thing?
There's probably no precedent for something like that too, to fall back on.
Well, it's totally uniquely them.
So, yeah.
And then he said, okay, right here's where I want you to play. And it's a little thing at the end of the song. And I thought, oh, geez, you know, I got really scared because I thought, oh, here's my first session with Alice, and I'm at a loss what I'm going to do, you know. So I said, well, Bob, what do you want me to play on? And he said, well, just play some Clapton blues. Just play some Eric Clapton blues over this thing at the end.
Really?
And I knew exactly what he was talking about. I went out there, and I started playing this Eric Clapton blues, and it was working. And I thought, another light bulb went off, and I thought, oh, I see. So if I can find blues in a solo, then I can play a solo because that's what I know the most.
Okay.
So if I can find blues in it, and blues is very melodic. It's a very melodic type of guitar playing. It's not so much just riffing and jamming. It's very melodic. B.B. King constructed phrases, and, you know, they were phrases. They weren't just riffs and stuff.
Right.
So that was another turning point, because from that moment on, every time I had to do a solo, I first listened, see if there's blues in it. And if I could hear blues in it, I knew I could construct a solo. And I tell you what, I've never run across a solo that didn't have blues in it somewhere.
I was going to say, I think that's kind of the foundation of rock and roll.
It definitely is.
So yeah. What you can do is you can change the tone a little bit, like whether it's the guitar, whether it's, you know, the amplification or the pedals.
It depends on the kind of melody. You can construct a melody out of a blues line.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
And if you want to beef it up, you can. Or if you want to, you know, tone it down tonally, you can.
Yeah.
And I think that you're right. I mean, I think that's I've always kind of felt that blues was the basis of everything.
It works for me. And it worked from that moment on. I didn't have any trouble coming up with solos. None whatsoever. Because I would just look for blues in it. I even had a guy one time ask me, well, is there blues in Salisbury Hill, for instance? And I said, well, sure there is. Listen to the melody. That's all blues. It's blues in a major sort of a way. It's like a major pentatonic.
Yeah.
But it's blues.
12-string acoustic at the beginning, right? Or no? Or did you double it?
It was three. I did three.
Oh, you tripled it.
Yeah, I did.
Okay.
I
was like, yeah, 12-string. But I'm like, but it doesn't quite sound like a 12-string. Yeah. But it does. It was weird, you know?
It's just a three, and you use a Varus speed on the tape machine. You could change the speed of the tape in little increments.
Cross
chorusing.
Yeah.
So you have three of them. You have one on each side and one in the middle. And they chorus beautifully with each other. I had to play the same part all the way through.
We can go on and on about everybody you've played with and all the stuff that you've done. I rattled everybody off at the beginning, you know, off the list. And there are some impressive people on there that I would love to hear stories about. Dr. John, you know, Glenn Campbell, all kinds of people. But you have quite five solo records? Or
Yeah, I think it's five, isn't it?
Six.
Okay,
you have six
records that span some decades too.
All the way back to the 77.
Yeah. Right, so not just all at once after you were done playing with everybody, but the whole time. So, what triggered that? I mean, I know as a player, everybody wants to have their own voice.
Yeah.
But you know, right from the start, you had kind of a great career not having to really worry about having your own voice.
Yeah, for a while, I didn't care about it. This is what I want to do because I liked the idea of jumping from project to project. Not only was it less boring to do that, but besides the boring, every time I learned something, you know, going from Alice Cooper to Peter Gabriel, my God, it was a huge jump for me.
Sure.
And on Peter's album, I learned so much about music because he'd written, his writing is very unique and very uniquely him. So, and what worked, what parts were, I was so enamored, and I still am, with the recording process. I have a Pro Tools rig, and it's just wonderful to go in there and noodle around and make sounds, you know.
Sure.
But I had written this thing called The Intro to Sweet Jane, which was on the Rock and Roll Animal album. And it got a lot of notoriety, and I think that's how Atlantic Records got kind of interested in offering me a deal as a solo artist. Of course, I wasn't going to be a like Foreigner, who they also signed that year. Okay. You know, I wasn't going to be that. But So I took them. I said, I'd love to do a solo album. And then I thought, wait a minute, I don't have any songs. I have to write some songs now. So I started writing songs. And I wanted Bob to produce it. So we got in the studio and I thought we finished it. But then Bob said, no, you know, we're a little short on time. And I thought, oh, God, I don't have enough. He says, well, wait a minute, I got this Beach Boy song. You want to hear it? It's called Sail on Sailor. Listen to it and see what you think. From the very first four bars, I loved it. I said, oh, we got to do that. So we sat down and worked out the chords, and I worked out the melody. And then Bob wrote sort of a blues thing in the middle of it.
Cool.
So it went, and it was some great changes for me to play blues over. And that got on the album, and it's like one of my favorite things on the album. Even though I didn't write it, it's one of my favorite things on the album. But that got me thinking, well, maybe there is something. I started thinking back in the early days, like in the 40s and the 50s and even into the 60s, there were a lot of hit singles that were instrumental. Well, the first one that comes to mind is, of course, Sleepwalk.
I was going to say Santo and Johnny. Santo, which that whole record is great, too.
Well, and he's a lap steel player.
Yeah.
The first time I ever heard a lap steel player have a hit record. That was unbelievable.
Yeah.
But there were lots of, well, look at Herb Alpert. Herb Alpert made his whole career on instrumental music.
I think in my record collection, Herb Alpert has about 3.5 or 4 inches.
Yeah.
You know, I have like probably 12 Herb Alpert records.
I learned a bunch of his stuff. So I started thinking, well, wait a minute, maybe I could be one of these guys that comes out with an instrumental song that's a hit. Well, I tried. You know, I never quite made it, but I'm still trying. I still believe that. But that made me start thinking in terms of an artist, because I've always thought that, for me, guitar is an incredibly expressive, soulful instrument. And it sings.
Yep.
And I'd rather it sing than me, because I can't sing worth a damn. So I wanted the guitar to sing. And I enjoyed the challenge of creating melodies. Even when I soloed, I try to create melodies when I'm soloing, melody bits, and I put them together. Or, of course, you do the guitar riffs that everybody knows, but what really was a challenge is to come up with a melody. And I fell in love with that. And I still am in love with it. I still think playing a melody on guitar is the most exquisite feeling in the world to me. So I'm still trying to figure out if I can write a song that everybody just loves and says, yeah, that's really cool. Let's have a hit record.
Yeah.
Instrumental hit record with that or something. I don't know whether I'll succeed, but the thing is, it's a joy to do. And each album, the Deacon album, which happened to be the next one I did, which was in 87, was due to Miles Copeland, who had started a label called No Speak, which was all instrumental. It was wonderful that I read a great big article in the LA Weekly. I was living in Los Angeles, at how he was talking about this label, and he was looking for a 70s guitar player. That's me.
Yeah, hello.
I got together some tape then, some cassette tape, and I sent it off to him, and he called me. He said, yeah, Steve, I like your stuff. It's good. You know, you want to do a record? And I said, well, yeah, I do, I really do. I was particularly hungry at that time. The 80s had been really rugged on me, and nobody wanted a blues-based guitar player in the 80s. They wanted Eddie Van Halen, they wanted Steve Stevens, mm-hmm. they wanted, you know, Andy Summers. Thank God for Billy Gibbons. He kept my sanity for me.
Because they made it through. They did their 80s versions, but they still made it through.
He still played blues.
Alice Cooper had to do his 80s record, which had some great songs on it, too.
It did. But, you know. There was a lot of bands in the 80s that I liked. There was a lot I didn't like, but there was a lot I liked. I loved Police. I thought Police was an awesome band, and great, wonderful songs and sound. I love Chrissie Hynde with Pretenders.
Yep.
But I couldn't find a niche, and I was trying to rediscover myself and reinvent myself and all that. Nothing was working. And then here in the LA Weekly is a guy looking for guys like me. So I thought, my God, I got to call this guy up. So it turned out he and I hit it off. I really liked him. And I've told this story before, and I had written a song called The Idler, and I had demoed it up at home. I had a little 8-track tape machine. So I brought it with me in a place. Yeah, I like it. You got enough for an album? I said, sure, yeah, I got a lot of stuff. And he says, okay, well, we got to get this thing done in a week. I want to get it out with all these other guys that are coming out. I said, can you get in the studio in a week? And I said, yep, no problem. Well, I go home. I'm panicked because I have no other song. I just have the Idler. Now I have 1 week to write an entire album.
Oh, man.
So I was panicked. But, you know, like I said, I've told this story before. There was something about being under that pressure that made the creative juices just gush. I mean, I was putting together songs. By the time the end of that week, I had an album.
That's amazing.
I was one song short. Miles said, I love your album, but we're one song short. We need another song. We got another song. And again, I lied. I said, yeah, sure. Yeah. So I went home that night and wrote another song. Nice. And went into the studio. That was an exciting time for me because I needed to know I could do that.
Yeah.
And up until that point, I don't think I really knew. I mean, I had written stuff, but I'd taken my time and noodled. The intro to Sweet Jane took like 3 years to finally finish and
get
honed down, you know. So here I am thinking, maybe I can write some songs, you know.
Well, that's probably one of those points where, you know, you had a gun to your head.
Yep.
You know, and this was your gun to your head for a good reason.
Yeah.
You're like, okay, I'm having a dry spell, kind of, and this guy wants to make a record with me.
Yeah.
So I think it was like the right kind of pressure.
It was perfect.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think in a different circumstance, one or the other could have caused you to completely collapse and get writer's block, you know?
Absolutely, because I had no confidence. I mean, I wasn't able to get work, so my confidence was down to nothing. I thought, wow, how did that happen? I woke up and the phone stopped ringing. And I wasn't getting work, and so you all of a sudden you think nobody wants your playing. Well, as a matter of fact, that's what it was. Nobody wanted to hear my stuff. One really interesting, I got called by a producer in the 80s. Oh, Steve, I'd really love to have you play a solo on this record. And I said, oh, sure, great. That was work, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
So I go down to the studio, and it's kind of an 80s style rock song. So I played what I thought was an 80s style rock solo.
Right.
And he said, no, it doesn't sound like you. Can you play it more like you? And I said, oh, sure, that's easy. So I played a solo that I would have played. And he said, well, yeah, but that sounds kind of dated.
And like, what are you trying to say about me?
What do you want me to do? So I said, well, here, let me try this other thing. So I started thinking about like maybe Beck or somebody like that.
Yeah, right.
And so I tried a Beckish. Nah, it's not working. That doesn't sound like you. So I said, well, I don't know what you want. And he said, well, I don't know. I guess it's just not working. He couldn't make up his mind what he wanted. And I didn't fault him for it because I think I understood why he was having so much trouble because I was having the same trouble. What the hell do you want me to play?
Right.
You know, you want me to play me or somebody, me playing somebody else, which happens a lot of times when you go in the studio. I've had a lot of guys say, can you play a Hendrix solo here? Well, I know what they mean.
Sure.
You know? But you'd like to hear them say, can you play a Steve Hunter solo here? That's really what you want them to say.
Yeah, right, of course.
But they don't do that often. They just say, just play a solo. Anyway, that kind of hurt. And that's how the 80s went for me, up until Miles.
Okay.
When he said, I want you to play. That's what we want on this album. The only stipulation was, I don't want you to just write chords and then jam over them. I want you to create songs. Which is right what I wanted to do anyway.
Yeah, right, exactly.
So that was good news to me. He's very patient. He's very kind. He's very generous. It's not what you normally hear with Miles. You hear he's a really hardcore businessman and all that stuff. And I loved him to death, and he was very good to me. He gave me a chance, gave me my confidence back, put me on the tour, you know, and stuff. I got my confidence back, and I felt better. It was awesome.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, that turned me around in the 80s.
And the problem with the arts, any kind of art, is, you know, if you have a long career with it, there's going to be those ups and downs.
Yeah.
You know, and starting off as well as you did.
Well, I just out of the
shoe. From a young man, you know.
What the hell happened?
It's like you're destined to have that moment where the phone doesn't ring. You know, like it has to happen at some point.
Well, I just wasn't ready for it. And I should have been, but it was my own fault. I should have been more prepared for that. And when I was teaching at MI Musicians Institute for a little while, and I told them that, listen, I don't care how successful you are, you got to remember that it's going to be a time when the phone stops ringing, and you have to be ready for that. You have to do whatever you can to prepare yourself for that. And there's really not a lot you can do. Just be ready for it. So you tuck a little money away, you know, and you take lessons, learn a little more stuff, you know, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
I ended up taking lessons during the 80s from a guy named Ted Green, who is, to my knowledge, he's a genius. He wrote a book called Chord Chemistry.
Okay.
And I've never met a man that knew more about guitar, and I never met a man that loved music and guitar more than him. He passed away, and I tell you, to this day, I miss him terribly because I learned so much from him, and he was such a joy to be around and so much fun. And he'd ask you, Steve, are you still loving music and guitar, and you're learning? Yep, me too. I'm still learning stuff. I thought, Ted, there's no way you can learn anymore.
There's only six strings on here. How much more can you learn?
You've got the same number of fingers. And
yeah, yeah. There's some guys, though, that just, they're mad scientists with
that
stuff.
Well, that's what he was.
Yeah.
Such a genius, and I learned so much on fretboard harmony and stuff from Ted that I use all the time.
Well, so, I mean, your career, you were still growing yourself through that period. I mean, that's the thing. You didn't just walk away and say, okay, I'm going to go get...
I almost did.
I know, but you didn't. And you did learn, and you grew.
Well, you
still
know what,
as an artist.
You know what happened? I had gone to the NAMM show specifically to try to find work because I was almost homeless at one stage. So a friend of mine said, Steve, I've got an extra badge. Let's go to the NAMM show and let's see what's going on there. Maybe you can find some work, or maybe I thought maybe I could be a product
demo guy.
Or something. Yeah. So. And I was really depressed. I didn't want to go to the NAMM show for that reason.
Yeah.
And I went there, and it was all this cacophony of Eddie Van Halen clones and shredders and all that
stuff. So this is in the 80s still?
Yeah, still in the 80s.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh, this is not going to work. It was like the early 80s, 83 maybe. And I just wanted to leave. I just got so depressed. I had talked to a couple of companies, and they kind of looked at me like, well, who are you? You know?
Right.
What do you know about? You know? And I thought, oh, this is not going to work. So before we left, my friend said, we walked by this Fender room, and he said, can we just go and look around? I said, yeah, okay, sure. Well, let's go see what Fender's got coming out this year. So we go in the room, and luckily it's all soundproofed, and the door closes. All that cacophony goes away, and I hear this gorgeous jazz guitar, just gorgeous. And I'm looking around the room, and there's a guy sitting on a stool, looks like an accountant. You know, he's got glasses and short hair, and this ancient Telecaster. I mean, it's a 52. Plugged straight into an amp with an ugly coral cord, and it just sounded like an orchestra. It was the most beautiful thing I'd ever heard about. I thought, what the hell? I've got to learn how to do that. If I can't work anymore as a guitar player, I got to play that.
Right.
I got to learn how to do that. So I tried to go up and talk to him after he finished playing. There was only like about six or seven people standing around listening to him. And he went to the back, and I didn't get a chance to catch him. So all the way home, I kept telling my friend, I got to find out who that was, and maybe he teaches. Well, it took me a couple of months to find out it was Ted Green. I knew who that was. I had his book on chemistry already. And I thought, wow. And then everybody told me, no, he teaches. Oh, my God. So I called him. I had to wait 3 months. He had a waiting list of 3 months. So I waited 3 months, finally had a lesson with him.
Wow.
And I played, he made me sit and play something just so he could watch my left and right hand and see how far along I was. And if I wasn't far enough along for him, then he would send me to other teachers that he recommended that would, you know, help me. If you're kind of a beginner, he really wasn't, you know. So I played a Beatles song. Here, There, and Everywhere, I think it was. And he had this gentle way of not looking at you while you're playing so you didn't feel nervous. It was really very cool.
Right.
But he would just glance over and see what your right hand was doing and see what your left hand was doing. And he said, yeah, you know, that's okay, that's very nice, and you've got good right hand technique and blah. But what if you played it like this? And he would grab his guitar, and then he did this phenomenal arrangement on the fly of the same bloody song. And I said, oh, okay, yeah.
Well, show me.
That's what I want to learn.
You know, I'm the grasshopper.
So he was, that's exactly right. Yeah. Snatched the pebble. And so, and that began this wonderful friendship. I took lessons from him every week. I told him my music theory is complete crap. I don't even know what key I'm in sometimes. It's terrible. And he says, all right, well, we'll get it all sorted out. And he had all this little homework he had to do. But I tell you, his enthusiasm and love for the instrument got me back into thinking that I could play guitar again, because I was thinking I got to get a job.
Right.
I got to get a job at Guitar Center, or I got to get a job, you know, at Roland demonstrating the guitar synth or something.
Right.
And here he's saying, no, man, play guitar. That's what you do. You play guitar. So, see, you can do that. He taught me this finger harmonics that, that Chet used to do, and Lenny Bro, you know, made very famous. And I learned so much about guitar that I got fell in love with guitar all over again.
That's exactly what I was about to say. So you reignited your passion for it, because you're looking at someone like him who still has a passion for it.
Yeah.
You know, that's incredible. Incredible.
He was like Yoda.
Yeah, you know?
You'd walk into his apartment, and there's nothing in there but guitars and books. There's no couch. There's nothing. There's a little pathway that he's kind of moved things out of the way so you can find him. And he's like sitting down. He's got a guitar, and there's guitars everywhere.
Wow.
There's guitars in the bathroom, in the bathtub, everywhere. And it was like Yoda.
Yeah.
You know, and it was, man, I look forward to lessons every week. I never thought I'd ever look forward to being a student again like I was with him.
Yeah.
And I talk him up all the time. I'm sure people are tired of hearing about it. I learned so much from him and had so much respect for the guitar. I have more respect for it than I used to have. And had more respect for music theory, which I always thought got in the way and bogged people down.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it doesn't, but I didn't know that until I understood music theory a little better. And then it's just a tool. It's just a little, some shortcuts and stuff. It doesn't get in the way. You still create.
Yeah.
It just helps you create, you know.
Well, I'm at the point where I need to learn more about that kind of stuff, and it probably would open up a lot of doors.
It really, really does. It really does. Somebody said to me, Dorian, it's a Dorian scale. I'd look at it and say, wow, that's wonderful. What's that mean?
Yeah.
But now when somebody says, well, it's Dorian, now this whole thing opens up that I didn't know about before, and I can see five different scales, and I can hear them, which is more important, that you can hear their effect on the chord changes and the chord changes effect on them, you know. And all of a sudden there's this wonderful interplay that I hadn't been aware of. I had been going on the fly, you know.
Yeah, right.
My ear was telling me where to play, and that was good.
That's fine.
And it still does. But now, if I want something a little different, I want to do this solo a little different. What would I do? Well, don't use that, Dorian. Use this inversion. Use this section. Move from here to here. And suddenly the whole thing opens up. A whole new set of notes. And it was like, yeah.
See, I need to learn that.
Yeah, it's really cool. It's really a cool thing. And the chordal things, I love chords. And he showed me so many things about chords that I just didn't even know, you know. And now there's no chord on any chart that scares me, where they would have been before.
You had the right teacher. I mean, he sounds like he was Yoda, like you said.
He was just Yoda, yeah.
Now, I want to move on a little bit. A couple more things I want to get to.
Yeah.
You've won an Emmy.
Yes.
Which is, for a lot, there are people in music that have won Emmys, but that's still something that's very, I think, rare.
It is.
Compared to how many players there are out there.
Well, this was a cool way, too, because what happened was I had a friend who worked on the Detroit Free Press.
Mm-hmm.
And they had, now I'm going to try to make sure I get this right, because I didn't fully understand how it all came about. So I may get some of the details a little funny. But she said that the Detroit Free Press had started a website, and they were going to start doing these videos on their website. Like video little documentaries.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of having links to them, they were going to do it. So they had done the first one they had done was on a home for homeless boys and troubled boys in the not so nice places in Detroit.
Right.
Trying to help place these boys. And it was a very tender, very sweet documentary, and these guys were so cool. It's like, wow, these guys are cool. Why aren't they in a family? You know, guys 14, 15.
Right.
All black guys, all little black guys, and they were all the coolest little guys ever. And she needed music for it. So I had written some, I had experimented a little bit with hip-hop. I thought, it's kind of cool, put guitar over hip-hop. Or I had done some rap records, I never knew where they went. You know, I just went in and they, here, play some guitar on this. I don't know who that was, who they were, the artist was, or anything.
There's actually some rap records that have some really cool guitar licks. Yeah. I'm wondering if that was you or not. I got to find out.
It was a while ago. I know one of them was had something to do with Tupac Shakur, but I don't know if it ever came out or any of that stuff.
All
but
right.
It was great because they just liked me to play blues.
Sure.
And then they would cut that up and put them wherever they wanted.
Right.
So I thought, well, that's a cool idea. I'm going to try that at home. So I tried some like little hip hop riffs and grooves and stuff. And I had done some music like that. And she said, have you got some sort of hip hop kind of things? And I said, yeah, just so happens I do. So I sent her a bunch of them and they liked them. So they ended up using them in this documentary. And the documentary won an Emmy. But the thing is, they couldn't separate out like the photographer, the writer, and all that stuff. The whole documentary got an Emmy. So I ended up, but I was part of the Emmy. So I got a nice plaque saying I won an Emmy.
That is great.
I was very proud of it.
Well, it's a good cause too. I mean, movies are great.
Well, it turned out every one of those guys got placed in a family.
That's fantastic.
Because of that documentary, every one of them got placed.
Yep, see the exposure. Yeah. That's amazing. Yeah. That's a really cool story.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, something we missed also, which I think is very important with your story, is you were drafted into the military.
Yes.
When you were 19.
Yeah.
And you became an X-ray technician.
That's right.
Which is really, I mean, that's, you could have had a good career with that.
I could have.
Afterwards,
and,
right?
And let me tell you, it was tempting a few times.
I'm sure, but at least you had that to fall back on, kind of, which is pretty cool. But that's not even what I'm getting at. There was a talent contest that happened.
Yeah.
I don't know the details. But I know this helped propel you toward career we know you for.
I was stationed in Okinawa.
Okay.
There's an Army Air Vac Hospital there. Now, of course, it's about 1,000 miles or 1,200 miles from Vietnam. So it's not like that we got people straight out of the field, although there were a few times we did. They were helicoptered to a carrier and then they sort of jumped their way to Okinawa.
Okay.
And they were usually pretty bad. And so I saw enough of war to last me my life without having to actually be there and be shot at.
I can imagine.
That's enough of that. I'm done with that. On Okinawa, was actually pretty cool. It was a pretty cool place. I actually had fun there I played in bands there and stuff.
Sure.
But as it turns out, somebody told me that there was a talent contest, all military talent contest. And I asked them what the categories were, and one of them was solo instrumentalist. So I thought, well, yeah, I could do something, I suppose. I'll just get a couple of guys and we'll do blues. So I got these two black guys that were really good rhythm section, a bass player and a drummer. And I said, we're just going to do blues. And, oh, yeah, that's cool. No problem. They were all into it and stuff. So we ran it down a couple times in rehearsal. And it just something like, you know, it's just 12-bar blues.
Right.
So I get introduced on stage. Now, you got a picture in the audience. To fill up the theater, any ambulatory patients from the hospital got to go to the theater to see this and for free, and they all got to sit up front. The ones that were ambulatory but had crutches and stuff, they were all in the front, in the front row. For whatever reason, most of them were black. Now, we could get into the politics of all that at some other point, but for whatever reason, there were a lot of black guys in the front row that were ambulatory, but crutches and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So I get introduced that I'm going to come out and do a blues song, and I come out and I'm a white guy. And these guys, they're booing me, and I thought, oh, my God, they're going to throw their crutches at me.
But what about my rhythm section?
They didn't care about that. They have I've got the balls to say I'm going to come out there and play blues.
Yeah,
and I'm
right.
A white guy?
Right.
And they were booing me, and I looked back at the guy and said, let's get this done and get out of here before they kill me. And they said, yeah, let's go, you know. So we get into it, and they're booing and hissing, and we start the tune, and they quiet down, and they start listening. The end of the song, they were cheering. And I nearly cried because I thought these guys hated me, and just my playing has stopped that.
And reversed it.
And they like me? Oh, my God. So as I'm walking off stage, it like literally walking through this bright light telling me I need to be a professional musician. this is what I want to do the rest of my life. I had planned to be a doctor. I was going to use the GI Bill when I got out to go through med school. I wanted to be OBGYN. I thought, what a cool way. All you do all day long is deliver babies. What a cool way to make a living. Yeah. I thought that was cool. Then I saw a couple of complicated births, and I thought, I don't know if I want to do that. You know, people's lives are at stake. I don't know about that. But it just hit me like a ton of bricks. This is what I got to do. I got to be a professional player. Because that moved me so heavy. I'm just a kid. You know, I'm 20 years old now.
Yeah.
And these guys changed their mind just by my playing. And either they felt some sort of sincerity from me, or I don't know what happened. I don't know what I did. I just did what I did.
Well, you commanded the room. And you know, it's amazing.
It killed me.
Yeah, I mean, I that would be my turning point.
Well,
that changed
my whole life, too.
Yeah.
That was like the one thing that made me realize that the guitar player is what I want to do for a living.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Well, if I could turn an audience 180 in 2 minutes from wanting to kill me to wanting to be my best friend, I think I probably would have chosen the same career path.
I just could not believe it. It's so awesome.
So I have to read this to make sure I read this the right way. Yeah. The next thing I want to let everybody know about is you were inducted into the Michigan Rock Legend Hall of Fame, apparently.
Apparently. Yes, apparently I was. I got an email saying that very thing. And I thought, well, that's really wonderful. That all I got was an email.
Yeah.
I thought maybe a little picture or something. But, you know, I'm proud of it. It's a very cool thing to be anybody that acknowledges. I was only there for not even a year. So I was very proud of it.
Yeah. This has been a great conversation. And, you know, we could go for another six days.
We probably could.
Stories. So before the cameras run out of batteries, there's one question I always like to ask at the end. And, you know, we're in Arizona. We're in, you know, the metropolitan Phoenix area of Arizona, if you could say. Do you think that there's a sound, musically speaking, you know, to Arizona or to this part of Arizona? Do you think there's something about being here that lends to maybe your songwriting or to somebody else's songwriting or anything like that? Do you have any?
Well, you know, yes, in a way, I think so. And if you take the whole state, like if you went to Sedona and you don't feel something creative being in Sedona, I think you better check your pulse. Because Sedona is one of the most magical places on earth. And every time I go there, I feel like I could write an album if I just sat there long enough, if I just sat there and let those red rocks absorb that.
Sure.
And it's the same thing being in the desert. There's something about the desert. It's an environment that can lend itself to, well, two things, serenity or raw harshness. So you've got two ways to look at it. It depends on how it influences you. Like you go out and see hundreds of saguaro cactus, just hundreds of them, you know, 20 feet tall and lots of arms and stuff. That's magic. And it has its own magic. But I think each place in America, each place in the world can do that to you. You know, you go to San Francisco, you're going to feel something else. You go to Los Angeles and New York City, you feel all these different things. What drew me to Arizona is I do love the desert. And I like saguaro cactus. Mm-hmm. I think they're beautiful. But also, I like the warmth, and I like that rawness. I don't know how else to put it. It's just this raw environment where it's a struggle to survive, but when you do, it's really cool. You know?
I understand that. I'm a desert fan as well, so I actually completely understand. Yeah, that's a great answer.
And when a cactus blossoms, you know, once every 20 years or something.
Yeah.
Man, that's magic.
It goes from being able to kick your ass to this beautiful thing for a moment.
Yeah.
That will then again kick your ass right afterwards.
Exactly.
For the next 20 years till it blooms again.
Yeah.
Well, on that note, maybe we should play a song.
Let's try to play a song.
All right. Yeah. 2, 3, 4. Thank you. I was like, I don't know, we can keep going. Yeah, we can bring it home.
It's blues, you know, you can keep going all night. That's good.